I'm Dr. T. Jayalakshmi, Professor in the Department of Genetic Engineering, Bharat Institute of Higher Education and Research, Chennai 73, is going to handle the course Genomics and Proteomics, course code U18PCGE403, and the topic is Protein Sequencing Methods. So first we'll discuss about the structure of proteins. So we all know that proteins are named as biomolecules, and they are the polymers of various amino acids. So we can predict the structure of proteins by variation in their protein structure and function. So why there is a variation in the protein structure and function is due to the difference in amino acid sequence in peptide chains. So in this diagram, we can see the protein structure and function, and also the difference in the amino acid sequence in the peptide chains. So there are different types of protein sequencing methods. So protein sequencing methods is the important technique to find out the sequence of various amino acids given in a protein molecule. Sequencing methods include N-terminal sequencing method, which is called as Edman degradation method. This is the most common methods used for protein sequencing. And the second one is C-terminal sequencing. And the third one is prediction from DNA sequence. This type of sequencing methods are mainly used to identify the various amino acid sequence in a protein. So a particular protein is a building blocks of various amino acids. So in protein sequencing method, we'll be having different types of sequencing methods. Mainly the Edman degradation method is the widely used method, and recently many researchers are doing research on Edman degradation sequencing, and it is the most commonly used method for protein sequencing. So first we discuss about Edman degradation method. Edman degradation method is otherwise called as N-terminal sequencing method. There are various steps involved in Edman sequencing method, and the first one is protein purification, and the second one is protein denaturation. We all know that protein purification can be done by using chromatographic technique, and also the separation can also be done. And the protein purification method includes mass spectrometry, chromatography, liquid chromatography, paper chromatography, etc. And the protein denaturation method is also involved. And then the third one is protein digestion. So after the purification process, denaturation will take place. And after denaturation, we can go for digestion. After protein digestion, N-terminal labeling is involved. So N-terminal labeling is the important step in the protein sequencing, and separation of labeled amino acid by chromatography will be taking place. After the separation of various amino acids, there are more lists available for the amino acid. We have to get the particular amino acid, and it should be labeled by chromatography. And then we have to detection through mass spectrometry. Mass spectrometry involves the atoms, and by using the detector, we can get the output, and data analysis can be done by using many softwares. In bioinformatics, many softwares are available for data analysis of protein sequencing. So after completing this mass spectrometry method, we have to go for data analysis with the help of softwares. First step is protein isolation. Protein isolation is otherwise called as protein purification. Protein purification can be done by SDS page. SDS page means sodium dodecyl sulfate polyacrylamide gel. In the right hand side, we can see the gel. And then the next one is two-dimension gels. So we can use two-dimension gels for the isolation of protein. In this gel, the protein of interest is immobilized by being absorbed onto a chemically modified glass or by electroblotting onto a porous polyvinylene fluoride membrane. So here we are using PVDF membrane for SDS page. So in the right hand side, we can see the two-dimensional gels. And before STS, we can see the structure of DNA, like charged R groups and hydrophilic areas are present. And after doing this STS, there will be the linear structure available. So before STS, we'll be having the coil-like structure. So the protein is having the loop-like structure. And after STS, we will have the linear structure of proteins is available. After purification method, we have to go for protein hydrolysis method, which is called as protein denaturation process. Protein denaturation can be done by heating a sample of the protein in 6 molar HCl up to 100 to 110 degrees Celsius for 24 hours or longer. But what is the importance of protein hydrolysis method is, so the linear molecule is converted into the protein molecule, which is called as denaturation process. So in this process, it may degrade some amino acid. So to avoid this, thiol reagents or phenol are used. So normally, when we are doing the denaturation process, so some amino acids are able to degrade. We have to avoid this degradation. To avoid this, we have to use thiol reagents or phenol and perfumic acid for intra-chain or inter-chain double S bonds will also be available for this. Next, the third important step is protein digestion. So in protein purification, the linear molecule is produced and then we have to go for denaturation. So in denaturation, to prevent the degradation of amino acids, we have to use thiol reagents and then we have to go for protein digestion. In protein digestion, we have to use endoproteinase lysine C, cyanogen bromide, pepsin or trypsin to digest the protein into a population of peptide. Protein digestion can also be done by various enzymes. Various enzymes include glucose and chymotrypsin. So this type of enzymes will normally degrade the amino acids and we can get the particular proteins what we need for the amino acid. So we have to add enzyme at 1:20 enzyme is to protein ratio. And after this protein digestion, we have to incubate the enzyme and also the protein in at room temperature for 6 to 9 hours. For better results, we have to use mixture of enzymes. So this is the protein digestion process. This table shows the common proteases and their preferred cleavage sites. So each type of protease enzyme is having the particular type and also the preferred cleavage sites. So here we can see some examples. Alpha chymotrypsin and subtilisins involving the serine type and preferred cleavage site includes tryptophan, phenylalanine, leucine, methionine. And the second one is elastase. In elastase, serine is the type and alanine is the preferred cleavage site. Pepsin is having aspergine and phenylalanine and leucine are the preferred cleavage sites. Thermolysin type is metallo and phenylalanine and leucine are the preferred cleavage sites. Pepine is having the cysteine as a type and leucine, valine are the preferred cleavage sites for this. And trypsin is having serine and clostrypine is having this cysteine type and the preferred cleavage sites include arginine. And then the next one is endoprotease lysine C, which can be isolated from the acromobacter, which is producing serine type and the preferred cleavage sites include lysine. And then endoprotease, which is producing the V8 protease enzyme, the type is serine and asparagine is the preferred cleavage site. Carboxypeptidase Y is having the serine type and xanthine is the preferred cleavage site. And carboxypeptidase B is having the metallo type and arginine and leucine are the preferred cleaving sites for that. An aminopeptidase M is having the metallotype and asparagine, phenylalanine and leucine are the preferred cleavage sites for this. And then pyroglutamate aminopeptidase is having the cysteine type and serine alanine is the preferred cleavage site. Cathepsin C and proline immunopeptidase is having the cysteine type and serine alanine as the preferred cleavage sites. So these are all some common proteases under preferred cleavage sites. So important proteases are listed here. Apart from this, many proteases are also having many preferred cleavage sites where we can get it from the bioinformatics tools. So what is N-terminal labeling? So the other name for Edman sequencing method is N-terminal labeling. So here we are using the Edman reagent, phenyl isothiocyanate, which is named as PTC. It should be added to the adsorbed peptide together with a mildly basic buffer solution of 12% trimethylamine. This reagent reacts with the amine group of the N-terminal amino acid, and the N-terminal amino acid can then be selectively detached by the addition of anhydrous acid. The derivative then isomerizes to give a substituted phenylthiohydronation, which can be washed off and identified by using chromatography, and the cycle can be repeated in N-terminal labeling method. So this diagram shows how the Edman degradation of amino acid sequencing takes place. First, we have to take phenyl isothiocyanate, which can be reacting with the mild alkaline conditions and having the pH of 9. And then it should be added to the anhydrous type of fluid, and then thiazolidine derivative is produced. So from this anhydrous formation, we have producing the structure of amino acid phenyl thiohydathionate amino acid. This is called as amino acid sequencing. So in Edman degradation method, the complex amino acid should be converted into the simple form. So in the first thing, we can see the complex structure of phenyl isothiocyanate, and at last we can see the degradation of amino acid takes place, and then we can see the simple structure of phenyl isothiocyanate. The next important method is chromatography. Chromatography is nothing but a molecules which are separated based on their volatility and bond characteristics when subjected to a carrier. So always there should be a carrier particle for the particular protein molecule, and then derivatives of amino acid can be separated using high performance liquid chromatography, gas chromatography. In gas chromatography, the mobile phase is in an inert gas where we can use helium as the main source. So in the left side, we can see the diagram of chromatography. So a carrier gas, here we are using helium. So we have to give the input as helium, and microvalve is inerting the carrier gas, and then it is producing fluoric precision sampling valve. And then chromatographic separation column is rotating the particular gas, and then we can get the pyroelectric detector. With the help of pyroelectric detector, we can get the signal processing electronics. So after that, so in this phase, so here we can see the inlet gas is produced. Inlet gas, which is called as helium, is also introduced into the sampling valve. So after introducing the inlet gas and the carrier gas, in the chromatographic separation column, the regularized temperature control is there, and then we have to give the power supply also. So after giving the power supply, signal processing unit will get induced, and then with the help of thermal display, we can see the results. So mass spectrometry plays a major role in protein sequencing method. It is an analytical technique which measures the mass to charge ratio of charged particles. So here we are using isoelectric focusing method. So based on the charge and mass ratio, the particles will get separated. So M is to Z, that is mass to charge ratio, is produced in the mass spectrometry method. So the mass spectrometry principle mainly consists of ionizing chemical compounds to generate charged molecules or molecule fragments and measuring their mass to charge ratios. Separated amino acid derivatives can be analyzed by using this mass spectrophotometry technique. Mass spectrometry procedure includes, first, isoelectric focusing step is very important, and then we can go for the MS procedure. So a sample is loaded onto the MS instrument and undergoes vaporization method. The components of the sample are ionized by one of a variety of methods. Example, by impacting them with an electron beam, which results in the formation of charged particles as ions. The ions are separated according to their mass to charge ratio in an analyzer by electromagnetic fields. And then the ions are detected usually by a quantitative method. And the ion signal is processed into mass spectra. And after that, with the help of a detector, we can analyze the electromagnetic fields which is produced in that. So this is the diagram of mass spectrometer. So first gas sample enters here, and then filament current ionizes the gas. After the filament current ionizes the gas, ions accelerate towards charged slit. And after accelerating the charged slit, we can see the ions separated by mass exposed film. So before entering into this method, magnetic field deflects lightest ion most. And then the ions are get separated by mass exposed film. So after doing this ion separated by mass exposed film, we can go for MS data analysis. So this is the first strategy for identifying an unknown compound, and it is also used to compare its experimental mass spectrum against a library of mass spectra. And then the standard solutions of amino acids are also used, and the resulting pattern is compared with standard spectrum. In the graph, we can see mass to charge ratio, the amino acid will get separated, and the graph is plotted with the x-axis and y-axis. And based on the mass spectrometry spectrum, we can analyze the increase and decrease in the graph plots. So limitations of Edman degradation method include, it needs pure samples of peptides, and it requires 40 to 60 minutes per amino acid, and it can analyze N-terminally modified peptide. And the most important is advantages. So though it is having more disadvantages, its main advantage includes most reliable sequencing techniques. When compared to C degradation and N-terminal degradation, Edman degradation is a most reliable sequencing technique for protein sequencing method. And the second one is C-terminal sequencing. So there are lots of differences between N-terminal sequencing and C-terminal sequencing. N-terminal sequencing mainly involve the amino acid site, but in C-terminal, the carboxy site is involved. The number of methods available for C-terminal amino acid analysis is much smaller than the number of available methods of N-terminal analysis. So the most common method is to add carboxypeptidases. So in N-terminal sequencing, we are adding more enzymes. But here in C-terminal sequencing, we are adding carboxypeptidases to a solution of the protein, which takes samples at regular intervals and determine the terminal amino acid by analyzing a plot of amino acid concentrations against the time. So we have to plot the graph with x-axis as amino acids and the y-axis is time. So if the time increases, the amino acid sequencing will also be increased and the graph should be plotted. So in C-terminal sequencing, we have to predict from DNA sequencing method. So DNA sequencer is also used in this method. So protein sequence can also be determined indirectly from the mRNA or in organisms that do not have introns. The best example is prokaryotes. In prokaryotes, it does not have introns and it can be used to predict the DNA sequencing. So sequence as a short section, perhaps 15 amino acids long of the protein can be used. And also it is used to design primers from the amino acid sequence and amplify the gene sequence. And the gene is determined using the amino acid sequence of protein. So we are using this C-terminal sequencing method for the designing of primers also. After the designing of primers, it should be involved in the PCR, that is polymerase chain reaction. So in this PCR, we have to amplify the particular gene and then the amino acid sequence of protein and the origin of protein should be isolated. This diagram shows the automatic protein sequencing. So in automatic protein sequencing, we can do labeling, separation, and analysis of amino acid at the same time. When we are going for the N-terminal sequencing, we have to do the process separately. But here in automatic protein sequencing, we can do all these things in the same instrument. So automatic protein sequences are designed to perform three steps like labeling, separation, and analysis of amino acid at the same time and can analyze data and can give results automatically. It is also named as automizer because labeling, separation, and analysis can take place at the same time. Applications of protein sequencing method includes it is used in recombinant protein synthesis, drug production, because we can produce the secondary metabolite also by using this protein sequences. So it is used in drug production, antibiotic production by using secondary metabolite generation, and then in functional genomics as a drug therapy and used to determine the protein folding patterns. It can be used in bioinformatics to design the software tools, and it also plays a vital role in proteomics. It is used for the prediction of final structure, function, and location of various proteins. It is also used to find out the location of the gene coding for that particular protein. Though it is having more applications, protein sequencing methods like N-terminal sequencing method and C-terminal sequencing method are the most commonly used method in protein sequencing technologies. And the next one is proteomics techniques. We can see about introduction to proteomic techniques, principal applications. So by using this technologies, we can apply it in the proteomics. And then we can use databases also. So computer compares sequences to other sequences which can be stored in an internationally accessible database. So here I said we can use it in the bioinformatics, and then it plays a vital role in proteomics also, which is used to find out the location of the gene coding for the particular protein. So that we can use the databases and in which compares the other sequences stored in an internationally accessible database. And this type of databases also determines the identity of the isolated protein. So why we are choosing bioinformatics and databases means, as the entire human genome is known, computers are able to determine nearly every potential protein. new proteins are discovered when they match sequences predicted by the computer that have not previously been found. So if you are a researcher, we can able to give the sequences. We can able to produce the sequences of anything like plant, animal or human sources. And we can deposit our data in the databases. And after getting the accession number, it should be seen by the other researchers. So other researchers or scientists or students can able to see your data, which is deposited on the data bank after getting the accessible number. So that when new proteins are discovered, we have to match it with our sequences predicted by the computer so that the databases are very essential in proteomics technique. So this diagram shows the isotope coded affinity tag. Here we are taking the biotin tag. So the green color indicates the biotin tag, and it should be linked with the linker, heavy or light. And we have to use the enzymes like thiol specific reactive group. So heavy means deuterium is used, and light means light linker. We can use two types of linkers, like a heavy linker and a light linkers. So heavy linkers example is deuterium, and the light linker is hydrogen. So we have to join both biotin tag and the thiol specific reactive group with the help of linkers. So in this animation, it consists of two parts. We can see the two parts. First part is ICAT and the second part is application oriented. First part contains the sample one. For the sample one, we have to tag it with the light linker, which is called as hydrogen, and the ICAT labeled. And the second sample, we have to tag with the heavy linker like vitrium, and we have to mix it with the mix both the sample one and the sample two, and then we can get the mixed samples. So after getting the mixed samples, we have to go for purification technique like affinity chromatography. And in affinity chromatography, it will separate the protein of our interest, and then we can go for the affinity purified peptides or taken to the mass spectrometry analysis. So we can use labeled mass spectrometry analysis. And then with the help of output, we can plot the graph. So in retention as x-axis and relative abundance as y-axis. So here we can see the red color indicates the retention time and then relative abundance. So if the retention time increases, the relative abundance will get decreased and vice versa. So from this animation, we can see that quantitative analysis of complex protein mixtures can be mixed using isotope coded affinity tags, and mainly with the help of heavy linker like deuterium and lighter linker like hydrogen. History, introduced in 1999. Isotope coded affinity tagging method is based on a class of chemical reagents called isotope coded affinity tags. Here we are using two types of reagent, heavy reagent and light reagent. Both depends upon the number of deuteriums. So in isotope coded affinity, which is called as ICAT method, it is a quantitative method for the analysis of protein sample. With the help of this ICAT method, we can label protein samples with heavy and light reagents. And the reagent contains affinity tag and heavy or light isotopes. So there are three forms of ICAT where we can use just a quantitative method. First one is chemically reactive group, which forms a covalent bond to the protein or peptide, and the second one is isotope labeled linker, which examples include heavy or light chain depending on what isotope is used. And the third one is affinity tag, and the affinity tag involves the protein or peptide bearing on ICAT to be isolated by affinity chromatography in a step. So in the right hand side, we can see the diagram of blue color indicates chemically reactive group, which forms a covalent bond to the protein or peptide. And then to the chemically reactive group, you have to produce the isotope label linker. And then we can go for the affinity tag. So the affinity tag should be specific to the linker and the chemically reactive group. Then only it can link together, and the affinity chromatography in a step should be taken place. Principles of ICAT includes the peptide sequence of the protein to be quantified between 5 to 25 amino acids long. It contains sufficient information about the peptide sequences, and then the peptide should be tagged with the light and heavy reagents respectively, and it should be chemically identical. Next, the principle of isotope code and affinity tags, as documented by Ebersold et al., was divided into four stages. So if you are going for ICAT, mainly it consists of four stages. First one is sampling, next one is tagging, and then isolation, and then quantification. So these four methods mainly act as a principle for the isolated coding affinity tags, and also it enables the criteria to select the linkers and adapters. So it is an in vitro labeling procedure that involves tagging of protein or peptide sample with the ICAT reagent. So in ICAT reagents include any protease enzymes specifically used at their cysteine residues, and the ICAT reagent consists of a biotin tag, a light or heavy linker chain, and a cis reactive group. So one sample is tagged with the light ICAT reagent, and the other should be tagged with the heavy ICAT. So if one sample at one end is tagged with the hydrogen means, and the other end of the next tag should be with the deuterium molecule. So in this diagram, we can see about the isotope coded affinity tags technology. Here ICAT reagents, a heavy reagent is deuterium, and the light reagent hydrogen is used. So biotin is linked with the linker, and then thiol specific reactive group is produced. And in the second diagram, we can see cell state 1 and cell state 2. So cell state 1 is the is having the light linker, and the cell state 2 is having the heavy linker. So ICAT label strains were produced, and then we have to combine with the trypsinase enzyme. So this trypsinase enzyme, what it will do means it will degrade the peptide bonds. And then affinity isolation can be done using chromatographic technique. And then with the help of mass spectrometry, we can detect the output. So on the right-hand side, we can see the graph plotting for these diagrams. So quantitative relative protein levels by measuring peak ratios. So in x-axis, we have to take mass into mass to charge ratio. And in y-axis, we have to take relative abundance, and the mass difference from stable isotopes is very high when compared to the relative abundance. And then coming to the identify peptide by sequence information through mass spectrometry. Here also, we are taking the mass to charge ratio in x-axis and relative abundance in y-axis. And here, mass difference from stable isotopes will not be there, but there is a difference in the NH2 group. So peptide isolation methods mainly include avidin. So avidin is a peptide molecule which is introduced to isolate the ICAT tagged peptides from the mixture through affinity chromatography. And the isolated peptides are then analyzed and separated by microcapillary high performance liquid chromatography, and also by using mass spectrometry. Applications of isotope tagged enzyme involved environmental monitoring and analysis. So though it is having more applications, it is mainly involved in the environmental monitoring and analysis. For example, soil, water, and air pollutants, and also it is used in the water quality technique. And it is second thing, it is mainly used in geochemistry, which determines the age, soil and rock composition, oil and gas surveying. And the third one includes chemical and petrochemical industry, where we can use this isotope tagged as a quality control mechanism. So apart from this environmental monitoring and analysis, geochemistry, chemical and petrochemical industry, it is having more applications in biotechnology also. In biotechnology, it is used to identify structures of biomolecules such as carbohydrates and nucleic acids. Apart from this carbohydrates and nucleic acid, it is also used to identify the structure of proteins like primary, secondary, tertiary and quaternary structures can also be analyzed. And then it is also used to analyze the sequence biopolymers such as proteins and oligosaccharides. So this type of isotope tagged is enzymes are used in many applications like environmental monitoring and analysis, geochemistry, chemical and petrochemical industries, and also in the various areas of biotechnology.